How about that? Are we excited today?
Yeah.
Tomorrow we don't have work. Well, most of us. I spoke with like 3 or 4 people. They have work tomorrow. Right? But yeah. I know, but don't worry, it's double pay tomorrow. I'm just kidding. Church, let me start by just sharing with you some things that I found. Finding the right job. Maybe we can all relate to this one time or another in our lives. Right? We are in the workforce, most of us are, and we have experienced some challenges in the workforce. So in honor of Labor Day, tomorrow is Labor Day, the first day of the month of September, right? Here's a first-person report of someone who was not quite as successful as he had hoped to be in the job market. When he was a young man, he said this, "My first job was in an orange juice factory. But I couldn't concentrate, so I got tanned. My second job, I manufactured calendars, but my days were numbered." So you gotta think in between the lines, okay? "Well, in my prime, I tried working in a car muffler company, but that was very exhausting. I wanted to be a barber, but I just couldn't cut it. I studied to become a doctor, but I didn't have enough patience for the job. I tried being a fireman, but I suffered burnout. But later in life, then I became a personal trainer in the gym, but they said I wasn't fit for the job. Well, I sold origami next, but the business folded. Finally, I became a professional fisherman, but I couldn't live on my net income. So I retired, and I find I'm a perfect fit for this job." Church, we're going to hear this message, the fruit of our labor. I'm hoping that my short introduction, well, not that, this coming introduction, would be an encouragement to us, because I found these 3 verses in the last portion of the Gospel of Matthew chapter 10. But before you come to this portion of the scriptures, these 3 last verses in verses 40 to 42, there's really a challenging thing that happened in Matthew chapter 10. This was the time when Jesus Christ was sending out the 12, his apostles, right, to go out in there and preach that the kingdom is near. And he told him, you know, a lot of things, a real life scenario, when we can all relate to this. You know, things are really hard out there. There's a lot of discouragement. There's a lot of frustrations, right? Things that, you know, one day you'll be up and about. The next day you think, you know, you get, I guess, according to the story we had, we got canned from our jobs. You know, there are little things that would encourage us to grind in our day-to-day lives, right? And we can see this in Matthew chapter 10, starting with verse 24. You would see here that God, or Jesus, is expecting his disciples to follow his lead. Like in 24 to 25, you will find in verses 26 to verse 31 that Christ is telling us not to fear the threats of this world, but to fear him. Right? In verses 32 to 33, we said we must confess our faith in him. We need to be encouraged by our faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And this is one thing I would like to focus today, our labor in the Lord. Yeah, today we're celebrating our labor in the workforce, that we deserve to have rest. That's why we have this celebration of Labor Day weekend. But this particular message will focus on our labor in the Lord. And in verses 34 to 37, you will find there that we need to really focus and remain faithful in the Lord, even up to the point of forsaking our family. This is a very challenging thing that Jesus is telling the apostles, right? Remember the apostles, when he called the 12, they left everything for him. Remember that? Right? And in verses 38 through 39, even their own lives, right? He who finds his life will lose it, he said. But he who loses his life for my sake will find it. And then we come to these last 3 verses in Matthew chapter 10. I'm sorry, Acts, our Sunday school. Matthew chapter 10, verses 40 to 42. It's about finding satisfaction in our reward, the fruit of our labor. So if you have your Bibles with you, and I know you do, open this or open your Bible in Matthew chapter 10. We're going to focus on the three particular verses here, the last portion of Matthew chapter 10. And this is my prayer for all of us who are really laboring in the Lord. When you wake up in the morning, you try to do your best. Yes, you can go to the workforce, go to your job, come home, take care of your family, do a lot of things. But as a Christian, as a believer of God, these are all being done in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are really working for the Lord. And I would like us to get encouragement with this. I don't know about you, but I need encouragement today to be reminded that there is a fruit in our labor. And we do deserve this. Amen, church? Right? Because sometimes our walk in this world, we have this mindset that our reward will only be there in heaven. Right? That's why we don't walk really with joy in our hearts, and we are surrendered to the fact that the Christian life is really a life of suffering. I tell you, there are rewards here in this world. Right? Obviously, the bigger rewards are there in heaven, right? With the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We're going to be with Jesus who sits in the right throne of God, but there is also reward here. And I would like to encourage you on that so that this will keep you going, growing daily, that there is fruit in our labor. And this is what Jesus also tried to do in Matthew chapter 10. After telling the apostles what they're going to mean in their lives, he turned around in verses 40 to 42. And look at this church, right? Follow me in verse 40. To be honest, this is a message for myself. Pastor, there's some sort of a selfish agenda for you. But I tell you, it has to be real to me first before I can share it. Do you agree, church? Yeah. I have to understand, put it into heart so I can share it boldly, right, with all of you. And I tell you, once we understand this today, it is my prayer that we will all be encouraged, right, to keep on going, serving the Lord, no matter what the cost. Verse 40, the scripture tells us, anyone who welcomes you, meaning us, Jesus is telling his apostles, remember, he's sending them out, right? Anyone who welcomes you, welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me, welcomes the one who sent me. And we know who is the one who sent Jesus. It is the Father. Isn't just, you know, we can just read verse 40 and we can call it a day. Thank you for coming, right? That's it. I think that, excuse me, that reward itself is something that we can take to heart. Allow us to be encouraged that if someone, anyone, welcomes us, right? If I am a pastor, I am delivering the word, and someone welcomes me or receives the word, he is receiving or she is receiving and welcoming Jesus. Anyone who welcomes Jesus welcomes the Father. But look at this, verse 41. If you want to be detailed in the rewards, you know, in our day and age, we are more into the reward system of things. Would you agree? If I do this, I need to get this. I won't do this because I won't get that. Right? We have this mindset. But look at what the scripture is telling us here in verse 41. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet, in other translations it says, in the name of a prophet. Anyone who welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet, what is the reward? Will receive a prophet's reward. Pastor, how much is prophet's reward? Is that $100,000? I'll tell you later, right? Come to my office, I'll tell you how much it is, right? And whoever welcomes a righteous person, as a righteous person, will receive a righteous person's reward. Wow. I mentioned already two rewards here, right? A prophet's reward, and a righteous person's reward. Who wants prophet's reward? Who wants a righteous person's reward? But look in verse 42. I think this is the catch-all. Catch-all reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water, it needs to be cold, not warm, to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you that that person will certainly not lose their reward. May the good Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word. The fruit of our labor. Verses 24 through 39 shows some discouragements in the life of the apostles. They will be threatened. Right? Jesus is asking them, right, to really remain faithful, even forsaking their family, even forsaking themselves. Right? But in these last three verses, we will find, you will find satisfaction. I found satisfaction in the rewards that is given. Three things, church, this afternoon. If you have your bulletins with you, right, I only have three blanks there, so it's very easy to be reminded about this. Right? First thing is this. We need to understand the fruit of reception. What is it to be received? Right? As a disciple, as a righteous person, as a prophet. Right? In Matthew chapter 10, verse 14, remember, he who receives me receives me, and he who receives me receives the one who sent me. Very powerful. So we know while the majority of the world is going to reject the gospel, majority of the world. Would you agree, church? Right. Would you agree that the majority of the world will reject the gospel?
Yes.
Okay. They will reject the gospel. But I tell you this, right? There will be some who will accept. Can you hear a big amen for them?
Amen.
They will accept. And when that is realized, right, we are rewarded by God. Of course, we will realize the blessing of this more in heaven, as I just mentioned earlier, right, more than this world. But it encourages us in here and now when we see the fruit of our labor. If our purpose really it is to glorify God, then someone receiving the message that we live and preach for Christ is to see our work pay off, so to speak. This is the best reward that we can do. If we are preaching and sharing the gospel, right, here in this world, that is really what our lives is focused on, our purpose is to glorify God, right, then our reward is for them to see that they have received Christ in their lives. It's ironic, right? How can that be my reward? They are the ones who are rewarded. You are not the one. What is the reward, Pastor? Just to see them receiving the reward? I thought the reward is for me. Right? Is that your mindset? Right? When we say reward, it's for you. Right? But it's really for you. You just don't see it this that way. I mean to say, right? It is like, for example, I have a son, but it's not an example. His name is Zachary. And my intent as a parent, and his mother as well, is to raise him up and to be, you know, the person God wants him to be. So that for us, when he becomes that, is already a reward for us, right? But if he has more rewards that comes his way, it's not only a reward for him, but it is also a reward for us. Parents, would you relate to that? Those who are your children here, that any rewards your children would achieve and receive, right? I think you feel it more than they do. And that is the same way here, right? That is the fruit of our work. When someone receives us, they are not only receiving us, they are also receiving Jesus. And they are also receiving the Father who sent Jesus. Our being received simply means that they received us as the Lord's ambassadors, right? And believe the good news that we share in Christ Jesus. And what is the good news? That he has died for their sins on the cross and has been raised victoriously over death. That is the message of the gospel. That is the reward that we're going to have. This is the fruit of our labor. And as a pastor, that is really all I can ask for in my life. To see, just even a single soul, receive me. Because when he receives or she receives me, it means receiving the message I'm sharing as ambassadors of Christ. And what is it? The good news about the death of our Lord Jesus Christ and his resurrection. That is the fruit of reception. Second thing, church, is this. The fruit of reward. Now, it's getting more interesting. It's easy to understand being received. But what is this reward? The Bible is telling us, right? As I told you, there's a prophet's reward, and there's a righteous person's reward, and even a disciple's reward. And what are these? Are we interested, church, to know what are these? Right? What is the level of this reward here? Right? Matthew chapter 10, verse 45. One, look at this. He who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. But those, and he who receives a righteous man in the name of the righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. Whether it is a prophet, and you know, a prophet is one who publicly proclaims the word, it may be a preacher, a pastor, or an evangelist. During that time, people would think of a prophet as the messenger of God. And I believe in this day and age, you can say prophet is also the one who shares the message of the word of God. Right? So these are the pastors, these are the preachers, these are the evangelists that shares the word, right? Or any righteous man, a believer who really does the work of a believer who is adhering to the word, active in his faith, doing a lot of ministry. Most of you here, you are righteous people. Being right with God and doing the right things for God. These are the righteous believers. And they are the ones who also shares the gospel with others. There are rewards associated with that when you receive them. Look at this again. When someone receives a prophet, in the name of a prophet, they receive the prophet's reward. So both of them, right, receives the reward. The prophet receives the reward, and the one who receives the prophet receives the prophet's reward. Am I saying that correctly? Right? The righteous man, in the name of a righteous man, who received a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. So if you are a righteous man, and you are being received in the righteous man's name, then you receive the righteous man's reward. Is that correct?
Yeah.
I mean, if you truly understand this, we are being rewarded by always to receive the reward in the name of either of one of this. One of this means to receive them on account of who they are. Right? Who they are. If we receive a prophet or a preacher or a pastor, right, you receive the reward. Because of a prophet, in the prophet's name, the prophet's reward. Because we receive a prophet who is a preacher of the word of God. Church, revival here, I want to focus on this reward, the understanding of this reward. This does not mean this is a prize. Maybe we have understood the reward sometimes, if not most of the time, as a reward. I feel lucky today. I'm sorry, I mean, we think of the reward as a prize, I mean to say. We feel that we are lucky, that's why we're going to win a prize. Right? Do we feel that sometimes? My wife tells me I'm always lucky in the raffle. I always win raffles. I don't try to buy raffles, but for what reason for that? There are some fun things that's happening, and I do win some raffles. Right? But this is not the reward that's being mentioned here. The reward that's being mentioned here is the wage, the payment for a particular work done. Okay? You cannot receive a righteous man's reward because someone receives you if you are not a righteous man. Are you getting that? You cannot be lucky to win a prize. You cannot receive a prophet's reward because you are a prophet and someone received you as a prophet. If you are not a prophet, and if you are not a preacher. And later on in verse 42, just even a regular disciple, you need to understand that the reward is associated for payment or wage given for a particular work. And what is this? Number one is this, God is our greatest reward, right? Is there anything better than this, right? Is there anything better than, you know, when someone receives us, he receives Jesus? Can you think of a reward better than that, church, right? Can you give, can you think of something that you can give someone? The person you love, your friend, your neighbors, your co-workers, that if they receive you, meaning the definition of reception, they understood that you are the ambassador of Christ and they receive the gospel that you're sharing. If they receive you, can you think of anything better to give them than God Himself? Nothing. That is the best reward, right, that we can see to be given to those who receive us. Whoever receives you receives me, the Bible is telling us, and whoever receives me receives Him who sent me. And second thing is this, right? Your reward is certain, right? Who among us here have been promised for a reward that was not given at all, right? Many, Andrea, yeah, I'm sure. One time or another, we have been promised that we are going to receive a reward. But for one reason or another, we cannot count on whoever promised us to be given a reward. But I tell you this, and this should be an encouragement to us this afternoon. And this is the encouragement that was given to the apostles during that time. Do you think it's harder before to share the word of God before during the time of the apostles, right? Oh, it was really even harder. I'm not saying, you know, we try to compare that, but I'm just saying today, right, there is a promise given to us that your reward, not the bride's reward, I tell you, it is not my promise, it's the scripture's promise, it is God's promise, that our reward is certain. A prophet's reward, right? As I mentioned earlier, a prophet speaks God's word. Christ reassures them. These are the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 41, Jesus is the one speaking here. Yes, some will receive you and they will be blessed. They will receive a prophet's reward. Second, a righteous man's reward, right? A righteous man does what is right and will receive a righteous man's reward. Look at this, intrinsic in life. Follow me, church, for a while. If you're a righteous man, like, this is your reward. There are intrinsic rewards in this life. Meaning, intrinsic is, you cannot probably see it visibly. You cannot really hear it, explicitly or implicitly, that this is your reward. But it is intrinsic, because if you are a righteous person, here is your intrinsic reward, right? In this life, for those who live righteously, people will respect you, right? If you are a righteous person, you will be faithful to people. If you are married, you will be faithful to your spouse. You will be faithful to your friends. You also help the needy if you are a righteous person. You keep your promises. These things are the path of blessings in the righteous man's life. These are the rewards that you experience intrinsically in this life. But there are also extrinsic, if I may use that word, rewards in this life. Even if you do not see the light at the end, the tunnel of this life, right? If you serve the Lord faithfully today, you can be certain that the reward will be great in heaven. So there is fruit of reception. There is fruit of reward. And last, church, there is the fruit of recognition. You might be saying, Pastor, you know, I'm not a preacher, so I don't have a reward. A righteous person, I'm trying, and I'm hoping I get there. But until I get there, are you saying I don't have a reward? Okay? The good thing, church, is that the reward is for everyone. The reward is for everyone who receives our Lord Jesus Christ. Just look at this verse 40. And whoever gives one of these little ones, Jesus is really very, I guess, protective to his little ones, to his disciples. Maybe this is a new believer. These are not, you know, these are not old-time believers to be considered righteous people. These are not the preachers. These are not the pastors. These are just regular believers. I don't want to use the regular believers because there's no way to call regular believers. But I know you know what I mean, right? These are those that are the little ones in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Look at what the verse is saying. And my prayer is to find encouragement in this also, right? That when you wake up in the morning, if your goal is to glorify God, If there are things in your life that is hindering you from doing that, if there are trials in your life that comes your way, but if the future looks bleak, trust in the word of God, and you find encouragement in this, that the Lord is looking after you. Because here is what Jesus is telling us here. And whoever gives one of these little ones only a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple. And look at this, these little ones. Giving a cup of water, is that hard to give, church? Right? I think it's just an expression that if any generosity or good or kindness is being extended to these little ones, for the disciples, for the believers of our Lord Jesus Christ. Those who do that, those who extend generosity, kindness to us, right? There will be reward for them. Is that an encouragement to us, right? That there is a promise for their reward, meaning we have been given this special place in the heart of our Lord Jesus Christ, that even though you are not a prophet, that there's a reward for a prophet, that even though you are not really considered a righteous person, you know, you're still going there. But if we are a disciple, a follower, a believer of Jesus, there is still a special place in his heart, and there is a promise, right, that we are going to be taken care of. Because there is even a reward to those who give care and concern for all of us. And the promise is this: I say to you, he shall by no means lose his reward. Is that an encouragement to us? The fruit of our labor in the Lord is for sure and certain. And the biggest thing is we will have God's presence. But the assurance, even for the littlest ones, to have this kind of reward, meaning God is really having us taken care of, regardless of whatever hindrances and obstacles and challenges come our way. God is there and he has put his hand on us to take care of all of us. Like the prophet and the righteous man mentioned the praise, little ones also speaks of the believers. You and I, we are all covered. If there will become a time that I'm not a preacher anymore or a pastor anymore, I am still covered. Right? Everyone who is in this room, if you have Jesus in your life today, you have a reward. Right? I always tell you that there are two very important relationships that we need to make sure that we have. Number one is our relationship with Jesus Christ. That is our ticket to the next life. That is our ticket to go to heaven. Second is our relationship with one another. That is the basis of our words. If someone receives us, that person who received us will receive God. Because he who receives us receives Jesus, and he who receives Jesus receives the one who sent him, is God. And if we are a prophet, he who receives a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. That is your relationship with your pastor, with your preacher. Oh, I'm going to say this. Are you taking care of your pastor?
Yes.
Let me say that again. Are you taking care of your pastor? Amen. You have me feed me later, right? Are you taking care of your team leaders who are righteous people? Your elders? It is your relationship with one another that will give you rewards. I don't think you want to give an amen because I'm challenging you today. A disciple's reward is this: the very truthfulness of God hangs on this certainty. God's or Christ's disciples and those who receive them will receive a reward. That is the fruit of our labor. Those who receive us will receive a reward. Can you imagine that? Those who receive us will receive a reward. Can you imagine the reward that will be given to us? If only those who receive us will receive a reward, how about us? Right? Are we going to have, you know, in our mindset, maybe we have a better reward? We don't know. But I tell you, for sure and certain, that there is no word. Last church is this, because Christ has promised your Lord will surely come. Church, let me ask you, let me pause for a little bit. Is a reward for sure? Are we going to receive rewards, church?
Amen.
This is an encouragement to all of us. Today, times are really getting harder. And there are signs that the Lord is coming soon. Right? There is this sense of urgency to keep on working. Right? To be vigilant. Right? To be vigilant in everything that we do. But I tell you, there is a reward for those who are faithful in God. Your reward will surely come, and it will not delay. Because what? Because God is sovereign. Look at this. We believe God's promises, which by His sovereignty, He will keep. And so remember, there is this responsibility in 2 John chapter 1, verse 8. The scripture tells us, watch yourselves, so that you may not lose what we have worked for, but may win a full reward. Church, if Christ sends you to speak in behalf of a prophet, which every single one of us may be, right? If one or God calls you to be a prophet today, to be a preacher, will you be silent? Will you not speak in behalf of Jesus? Remember, there is a reward. There is a reward, a prophet's reward, for those who receive a prophet. For this afternoon, church, you are being called to be a righteous person. Will you not do it? Will you not give alms to the poor? Will you not help someone who is in need? Will you not share the word for those who are thirsty? Remember, there is a righteous man's reward. But this is my last question to you. You want to be a disciple of our Lord Jesus Christ today? If you are not yet a disciple, remember, there is a believer or disciple's reward that is given. So anyone who receives you and gives you even just a cup of cold water, Jesus assures you that that person will not lose his or her reward. But last point, church, this afternoon, before I ask you to stand up, I want some of you this afternoon, my prayer, if it's possible, to receive a prophet's reward. And how do you receive a prophet's reward? You receive a prophet's reward if you receive me in the name of the prophet. If you receive me, you receive Jesus. If you receive Jesus, you receive God who sent Jesus. If you receive me, meaning you receive that I am an ambassador of Christ, and you're receiving the gospel I am preaching, that Christ died for you, and He resurrected from the dead, so that you will not experience death. Any one of you this afternoon who are here, you are not here by chance. You are here to receive a prophet's reward. How about that, church? So I ask any one of you this afternoon here who wants to receive that reward. Receive the gospel today. Accept Jesus as Lord and personal Savior. And I tell you, we will all receive the fruit of our labor. Let's all stand up, church. Let's give glory to God. Let's sing this song.